alhamdulillah, very much. But no mother can say, I love exactly both my children at the same level. It's not possible. There has to be some Apollo. But overall, there should not be injustice. So Quran says, it's impossible to justice between your wives, but don't turn away from them altogether. Regarding the other things, where it comes to money, time, etc., you should be just between your wives. If you buy one house for your wife, the second wife gets the same house. So the Quran says you're only allowed to marry more than one wife if you can do justice. If you can't do justice, you cannot. Many people think that marrying more than one wife is compulsory in Islam. That's a misconception. In Islam, there are five categories of do's and don'ts. First is fard, which is compulsory. Second is mustahab, that is recommended or encouraged. Third is mubah, that's optional. Fourth is makruh, that is discouraged. And the fifth is haram, that is prohibited. Polygyny, a man allowed to marry more than one wife, comes in the category of optional, the middle category. There's no verse in the Quran saying that if you marry more than one wife, you get more sawab. Now let's analyze why does Quran give the permission that in certain circumstances you can have more than one wife. By nature, men and women are born in equal proportion, male and female, they're born in equal proportion. But during the pediatric age itself, if you ask any pediatrician, he will tell you that the female child can fight the germs and diseases much better than the male child. So in pediatric age itself, there are more male children dying than female children. So in the pediatric age itself, the female population is more than the male population. As life goes on, death takes place due to accident, cigarette smoking, wars, etc. In all these cases, more male are dying as compared to female. So today in the world, there is more female population as compared to male population. It's only in certain countries like India that the male population is more than the female population. And as I said, it is because of female infanticide. And according to a report of BBC by Emily Beckenin on the program assignment, the topic was Let Her Die, she said that every day more than 3,000 fetuses are being aborted in India alone after they identified that they're females. If you multiply this figure by 365, the number of days in a year, more than 1 million fetuses are being aborted every year in India after they identified that they're females. If you stop this evil practice, even in India and some other countries, the female population will exceed the male population. According to statistics, USA alone has 7.8 million females more than male. New York alone has 1 million females more than male. Out of the population of New York, the statistics tell us, one-third are gays. Gays means sodomite, means komelud. That means they wouldn't like to have female life partners. There are more than 25 million gays, sodomites, in America, in USA. Another problem. 25 million. In UK alone, there are 4 million females more than male. In Germany alone, there are 5 million females more than male. In Russia alone, there are 9 million females more than male. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows alone how many millions of females are there more than male throughout the world. Suppose I agree with the Western philosophy or a non-Muslim who says that one man should only marry one woman. And suppose my sister happens to live in America. And suppose the market is saturated. That is, every man has already taken a woman for himself. Yet there'll be 30 million females who will not find life partners. 7.8 million as it is the excess, and the 25 million gays if you add it to them. There are more than 30 million females who will not find life partners. Now the only option remaining for my sister, or suppose your sister happens to be in America, and she's that unfortunate one who has not found a life partner. If she can find a man who's not married, alhamdulillah, grab him. But suppose the market is saturated. What she will do? The only option remaining for her is that she either marries a man who already has a wife, or she becomes public property. Now people say, public property? Dr. Zakir using such a harsh word. I am saying that's the most sophisticated word that I can use is public property. You know, I cannot use other words because I'm a dai. Public property. There's no third option. And any modest woman would say she would prefer the first, becoming the wife of a man who already has a wife, than to become public property. And you know, in the Western world, it's very common. People have mistresses, very common. The statistics of USA tell us that on average, one man has 8 different sexual partners before he settles down with one life partner. Some may have 10, some may have 20, some may have 30, some may have less, 2 or 1. On average, 8 different sexual life partners before he settles down with one permanent one. Having a mistress is no problem. You can have 1, 10, 20, 30, no problem. But if you ask any woman, when a woman becomes a mistress, she doesn't have honor. She's degraded. She doesn't have any rights. As compared to a woman, when a woman is the second wife of a man, she gets honor, she gets respect, she gets the rights. We in Islam, alhamdulillah, give the woman the due rights. For the Western world, they can easily agree with the philosophy of a man having several mistresses. But a person having more than one wife, it doesn't go down their throat. It doesn't go down their throat. Islam has a solution to the problems of humankind. Islam has the solution. And Islam, besides speaking good things, don't do adultery, don't do fornication, etc. Islam has a solution to all these problems. If you analyze most of the major religions, they speak good things. Don't rob, don't cheat, etc. Islam says the same. But the difference between Islam and the other religion is that Islam, besides speaking good things, it shows you a way how to achieve that state of goodness. How to achieve that state in which these particular principles, laws can be followed. For example, all the major religions, including the Western world, says that a person should not rob. If you read the Constitution of America and Europe, it says that a citizen should not rob. And if he robs, there are certain remedies given, but it's not showing its colors. Islam too says that you should not rob. But Islam has a solution. It shows you a way how to achieve that state in which people will not rob. Islam has a system of zakat. That is, every rich person who has a saving of more than the nisab level, 85 grams of gold, he should give 2.5% of that saving in charity every lunar year. If every rich person gives zakat, poverty will be eradicated from this world. There will not be a single human being who will die of hunger. And after this, the Quran says in Surah Ma'idah, chapter number 5, verse number 38, as to the thief, be it a man or a woman, chop off his or her hand as a punishment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The non-Muslims will say, the Westerners, chopping off the hands in this age of science and technology, Islam is a barbaric religion. It's a ruthless law. And they think that if you go to Saudi Arabia where this law is practiced, every second person you come across will have his hands chopped off. I've been to Saudi Arabia several times. I have not come across a single man whose hands have been chopped off. Surely there will be few people who have got this punishment, but it's not as common as they think it will be. And they say, if a person, if he robs and his hands are chopped off, what about his family? What about his children, etc.? It's a ruthless law. I say Islam takes care of that.